The last morning lecture of this part of the course. Before I get started on the PowerPoint slides that I put together, it occurred to me that I was curious who had had a chance to look at the 1972 paper by Ray Weiss that was a suggested reading in advance. Did anyone have a chance to look at it? Great, okay. Go back later and read it. I highly recommend this paper. Let me tell you a bit about what it is. There was a, you may recall that I mentioned that in 1957 the problem of whether gravity waves were real was solved in a talk at the GR1 conference in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. The talk was given by Felix Pirani. In the audience at that talk wasn't Ray Weiss, there'll be a bridge, was a guy named Joseph Weber, who realized since gravity waves were real, it would be really interesting to try to detect them. And he immediately set about trying to invent gravity wave detectors and make them work. And by the late 1960s, these were the so-called bar detectors that were the way people tried to detect gravity waves from around the mid-60s until, around 1990 or so. Weber thought he was actually seeing gravitational waves, and there was a really big excitement followed by controversy as people tried to figure out whether Weber's gravitational wave putative events were real. Ray Weiss had been too young to be at the 1957 Chapel Hill conference, but he was just a few years younger than Joe Weber. Was a very active young physicist in the late 1960s and early 70s when this apparent discovery of gravitational waves was announced and was being discussed. And he was the person who realized more vividly than anyone else that we could make much more sensitive detectors than Weber's. The Weber detectors were cylinders of aluminum about as big as this table. And the way they were designed to work was, think of a cylinder of aluminum this big and think of it conceptually as being divided into three parts. The two ends, think of them as test masses, and the middle, think of it as a spring. Since you're all more sophisticated physics students than that, you could think of just the fundamental longitudinal mode of the cylinder, but I like to think pictorially, so think of two test masses and a spring. A gravity wave that comes by tends to want to either pull the two ends apart or squeeze them together. And so if a gravitational wave comes by, that fundamental longitudinal mode will be set into vibration. And with the right set of vibration sensors, and Weber used piezoelectric transducers, little crystals that if you stretch them or squeeze them generate a voltage. He glued them around the midpoint, the spring part of his detector, and looked for non-thermal excitations of those bars. And in fact, he built one in Maryland where he was a faculty member at the University of Maryland, and another at a federal research lab in Argonne, Illinois, and looked for coincident excitations of those bar detectors. As it turned out, he must have been making a mistake, because after he announced that that he had seen gravity waves, people were so excited that a lot of people made very similar detectors and set them up, and no one else found coincident excitations of their detectors. So by 1972, when this assigned paper was written, people were wondering, well, could I really make a detector that worked a lot better, was a lot more sensitive, to finally lay the controversy to rest if Weber was wrong, or to exploit this amazing discovery if it was right? Either way would be interesting. And so the insight that Ray had was, there was no necessary reason to just have your test masses so close together, because it wasn't required that they be connected by a mechanical connection. Now you might say, well, let's just make a cylinder of aluminum that's a lot longer and get more sensitive, but then the resonant frequency goes down because it's set by the length. And the whole idea kind of breaks apart if you try to make something really large. But Ray said, why not have the test masses be physically separate, be free instead of connected by this springy material? And then I just need to invent this way to measure the relative separation. So he went through that same thought process that I outlined on Monday. But not only did he invent the conception of the experiment, he actually, on his own, toiling in obscurity at MIT, worked out everything we've been talking about all week. Not only how the thing ought to work, but all the noise sources, including a number that I haven't had a chance to talk about with you. And he realized that the whole system would need to be held together by feedback control, because the noises he could evaluate would cause the mirrors to move by too much for the very sensitive interferometric readout that he was proposing. So this is the first diagram of an interferometric gravitational wave detector. It has three masses only, just one mass at the corner carrying the beam splitter and some other parts, and two mirrors on it. It's not a design we've chosen to copy. Mirrors at each end of the long arms. And what I wanted to call out to you here is that here's the dark port, here's the laser, here's the dark port. Here is the output going to recorder and signal processing equipment. And now here is a low pass filter and an actuator and a feedback force being applied to this end test mass to either push on it or pull on it to keep the two arm lengths matched in a way that would let the interferometer continue operating in the presence of a lot of disturbances. So I realized this was sort of not only the first proposal for an interferometric detector, but in it was the recognition of the necessity of feedback to make these things work. So if you haven't had a chance to read this paper, go back and read it over the weekend or next week sometime. I consider it not only a remarkable historical document, but one of the most amazing feats of creativity in experimental physics, in the history of experimental physics. Now, I have to be a big fan of Ray's, you can tell. But it makes great reading. It summarizes the observational situation, sketches how the antenna ought to work, and then explains everything that's going to be difficult before it actually is made to work. Okay, so now let's talk about feedback control systems. I haven't been able to speak about everything else without giving a hint that we were going to have to talk about this by Friday, and now it's finally time. So I'm going to cast most of what I say in more general terms than just the application to a gravity wave detector, because this is a field of tremendous power and beauty. This is one of the subjects, I think I mentioned this before, that I think physics made a great sociological error in surrendering to engineering, but it's okay, we can take it back when we need it. So I want to say in general, why do you use feedback? What is it? How does it work? What does it give for you? And we'll look at some examples of applications, first in systems smaller than a whole interferometer. Talk about some of the troubles, and then we'll close by examining a diagram of how and how much feedback needs to be used to keep an interferometer like LIGO in operation. All right, so first let me show you a few situations in which it turns out feedback is the answer to a particular question. All right, over here, not drawn, is a laser. here drawn, isn't, who recognizes what this is a schematic of? It's a Fabry-Perot cavity, two curved mirrors. All right, here's some other stuff in front of it that I will probably mention later on. But the question is, this, remember, the Fabry-Perot cavity does this amazing thing of serving as a very nice and compact beam folding device, but it only does it if there's been a careful adjustment and matching between the length of the cavity and the wavelength of the laser light. Doesn't just happen for free. And as we saw when we talked about Fabry-Perot cavities, if you just try to do it at random, odds are you're going to miss, and not know where you are, in fact. So it's a really big question, one of the most important needs for feedback in a detector like Advanced LIGO. Now, here's a different sort of situation. By now, you probably recognize a schematic mirror with a pendulum suspension from some frame. When we were talking about thermal noise yesterday, by the end of the day, we were saying, oh, I've got a great scheme for making test masses have really low thermal noise. I'm going to make their Q be 2.5 billion. And that's great from the thermal noise point of view, but you know what that means if you accidentally bump the mirror? It means it swings for 2.5 billion radians before the amplitude drops substantially. And at a period of about a second, think how long you have to wait. So this solution to our thermal noise problem creates a practical problem of rather great drama, that test mass is something that would never sit still in the right place. We talked about vibration isolation, and you may recognize this as a schematic of the initial LIGO stack mass with a spring that suspends a mass with more springs that suspend more masses. That is an effective design that has served us well, and even in Advanced LIGO, we've got not that exact implementation, but something that uses the same principles to work. But what I don't think I emphasized when we were talking about seismic noise is that when you make so-called passive isolation systems like this, if you are tempted to try to make it operate at a lower and lower resonant frequency, you can do that by making softer springs or more massive masses. But the price that you pay is that under gravity, the softer springs compress more. And there's a little theorem that says that unless you have a really unusual spring design, in almost all cases, the amount of sagging under weight is equal to the length you would have to make a pendulum to have the same resonant frequency. So 3 hertz, that's not too bad. That's maybe a sag of this much. But 1 hertz is already like this. So it's actually really hard to design sufficiently soft, low frequency passive isolators. And the one really heroic version of that was Virgo. And what do we know about it? That fabulous thing is 7.5 meters tall. So you can ask whether there's any way around this, whether you can modify the dynamics of a set of masses and springs using feedback that can trick up in some way a low frequency vibration isolator without some of the mechanical problems of doing it directly. So what I'd like to suggest is that all of those are examples where feedback comes to the rescue, not to mention just holding a whole interferometer together, which we've been talking about off and on the whole time. So what I'd like us to do is ponder a generic feedback system, and I'm going to use this diagram so much that I'm going to copy it onto the blackboard so we can point to it later. But let's walk our way through it one bit at a time. Most of this is going to be actual physics content, but it also involves teaching you some jargon, some of each. So I'm going to start. First of all, what I have to tell you, what does a rectangle with two lines on either side mean? This is going to be my generic symbol for a linear system. Here's the system. It has some dynamics that I'll start describing or labeling in a minute. This represents the input. This represents the output. Okay? And remember, linear system theory is this abstract thing where we can say, I can give you a complete description of a linear system if I can tell you what its frequency response is, where that frequency response is defined as, in the frequency domain, the complex ratio of the output to the input. So it's a kind of tool that lets us talk in an abstract way about all sorts of different things and represent it by really simple diagrams. So the first linear system I want to talk about is the one that's called the plant in feedback world. And plant, I can guess where the word came from, but don't worry about it. That's the jargon term for the thing that you already designed, that you realize that after you designed it, you want to improve it by feedback. So everything else on this diagram is part of what a feedback engineer does, but this is what the feedback engineer employer provides to the engineer and says, fix it. I don't know how to make it work. Okay? So this is the fixed stuff. Now, in some cases, even good feedback won't fix it, and then there has to be an iteration between the feedback designer and the designer of the plant. But for purposes of this discussion, we'll just assume that this is something that's fixed. All right. So this is the output side of the plant. So I'm just going to label it for now, plant output. And I think later on I'm going to call that small p. And let me represent the frequency response of the plant itself as p of f. Now, this is the thing you really want to control, the plant's output. Before you can control it, you have to know what it is. So every feedback system has a linear system called a sensor. And you hope that this is relatively easy to make. And you hope that its dynamics are not all that important, that its frequency response is close to frequency independent over a huge range, but in principle, it does have some frequency response. Nothing can be a faithful linear system up to arbitrarily high frequencies. All right. So here is the sensor output. The sensor's input is the plant's output, P. You really care about the plant's output, but in order for you to see it, you actually need to look at the sensor output. All right, so this enables you to see what's going on. Now I'm going to have a linear system where this is the input. Let's draw some arrows so we don't get lost here. And this is the output. Let's make this a placeholder for the designer's capability to modify frequency responses of everything else. So we're going to call this our filter. At a few minutes to 12, you don't know why I should bother to include a filter, but by the time we break for lunch, I hope you will know exactly why this is, in some senses, the most crucial part, or maybe at least the most interesting part of a feedback control system or a servo. Okay, so we could look at this. Let's draw that. There's one more linear system. This is the actuator, because of course you can't do feedback unless you can act on the plant to modify what it was going to do in the absence of your feedback. So this is the pusher. I've drawn it sometimes like a fist. But every feedback system need to be able to look at it. You need to be able to act on it. And now we've been able to sketch an entire closed loop. Now, I haven't yet explained how that closed loop behaves and how to think about it, okay? It seems like something that bites its tail would be hard to understand the dynamics, but we'll make that clear in a little bit. So let me just add a couple of other features to the diagram. I'm going to add two more inputs. We'll call this one the control input. And this symbol represents a summing junction. For those of you who've made op amps, an inverting op amp with a couple of resistors at the negative terminal, or you can implement it digitally just by an arithmetic operation. And almost as importantly, this is a disturbance input. This represents the fact that the world is shaking the plant. It's seismic noise shaking the mirrors that determine the length of a Fabry-Pro cavity, for example. And in the applications that are most interesting to us, taming the effects of the disturbance input on the plant is the reason that we want to do this feedback. So look for my explanation of that. It's also the case that in a variety of situations, we want to use feedback just to sort of steer the plant into some state, to, you know, arbitrarily lengthen the arm, to steer a mirror in some way for some reason. So this is the deliberate input that the operator applies to the plant. And I've put it here because that input needs to use the actuator to push on the plant, whereas the disturbance input can come through a variety of paths, and so we'll conceptually put it in a different place. All right, let's give this a frequency response, A of F. All right, I think that's generic enough to describe any feedback control system, and it's generic because, of course, these can describe the dynamics of whatever it is. So we use linear system theory to generate these frequency responses, and then we are describing, in principle, a general system. Okay, so let's see if there's anything I forgot to say. Yes? Oh, sorry.
When we are already filtering the signal,
okay, so this is an object that may need to have very special properties. In particular, the property that makes it an actuator is that while its input is some electronic signal usually, some voltage, its output may need to have a variety of different forms. For example, if this plant is a Fabry-Pro cavity with two free mirrors, the output of the actuator is some force. So in that case, this would describe, if we were talking about initial LIGO, a set of coils in vicinity to a set of magnets that are glued onto a mirror. All right. So this is something that has that very specific function of changing the character of the signal as you go around this loop from whatever is the convenient part, normally electronic voltages or digital signals that were digitized from electronics, whereas up here we're dealing in the real world, whatever is the real world of the plant. So that's the role of this box. Whereas here, this is something where the designer needs to be free to play around and modify the properties of the signal so as to get the best performance. So in every case that I know of, this is either analog electronics with a voltage in and a voltage out, or a set of digital operations where somewhere there was an analog to digital conversion that's going to be undone here by a digital to analog conversion, and here it's a set of arithmetic algorithms. So this is a kind of object that specifically doesn't change the dimensions of the signal as you go from one end to the other, but it's just there to give you design freedom. This, your employer gives you, this has to change from mechanical variables, if you're looking at a mechanical system, to electronic. This has to go from electronic to mechanical. This just lives in the world of either digital numbers or voltages. And thank you for this question especially. Now you can see that this is the only really place where you have complete freedom. There's only so many ways you can sense a position. I mean, it's probably more than you can think of, but still, it's a finite number, and there's only one or two choices that are good for a particular situation. There's only so many ways you can push on something, and there's probably only one that's right for your particular situation. But in principle, you can design any kind of filter you want. And you don't want to start without that freedom, because in fact, this is a hard enough subject. So That's what this is doing, and we'll see more later.
So why can't one use an appropriately filtered sensor signal as the control signal?
You can. You can, but in that case, it would amount to either putting the filter here.
No, you have filter and a sensor signal.
Okay, I have
so
a.
Why do you need extra control input to the loop?
Oh, why the extra control input? Where else should I put a by control? I guess I should call this a command input. I'm sorry. Yeah, that's a better word. A command input. This is the arbitrary input. Okay? Whereas, all right, so this, someone walks into the control room and says, you know what, I don't like the way that mirror is pointing. I want to point it there. All right? This doesn't come from the dynamics of anything. This is a human choice. So I used a bad term. I'm sorry. Command is much better. Does that clarify the okay.
So
yes.
Yeah. The meaning you told that to achieve the resonance in the fabric cavity, you have to match the length of
yes.
the
mm-hmm.
cavity with the wavelength of the laser.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So how is the resonance achieved?
Aha, okay. So let's talk about that particular example. That's great, thanks. All right, so here is a laser. Here is the Fabry-Pérot cavity that we want to match the laser wavelength to. Now, you may know, or I may have quickly mentioned, that in every laser I know of, an internal thing with a length, namely another resonant cavity, that kind of determines the wavelength, although as you remind us, it is the wavelength that comes out is broad enough that it's not obvious how to match it. Now, what we want to do is somehow sense whether there is a good or a bad match between the wavelength and the length of the cavity. So we have to invent some kind of sensor. This is not the way we do it, but for purposes of getting started, I'll say, what if we look at the amount of power that goes through, knowing that it should be big if there's a good match. There's a better way to do this that I'll mention in a little bit. Okay, so let's say that's our sensor, and then you're asking, how can we actuate on the laser wavelength to make a good match? So let's put our filter in there just so we don't forget about it, but I won't have too much to say about it. Now, in general, I'm going to have to send actuation signals two places. Usually, we need a fast control because this mismatch can vary on very rapid timescales. And the fast control is a phase modulator, usually implemented as a so-called Pockel cell, which uses a crystal, a nonlinear crystal, and KTP, and I don't remember what that is, except the K is potassium and the P is phosphate or phosphide or something. And ADP is another thing. There's a small list of particular crystals where you can change the polarization, the orientation of polarization of some molecules, and thus change the index of refraction, and thus change the optical path length very rapidly by applying a voltage, and the response time is very quick, so you can modify things at tens of megahertz. They don't have a very big dynamic range, that's the drawback of a Pockel cell, but it has the advantage that you can have an instantaneous look, in principle, at the mismatch between the phase of the laser light and what the phase ought to be if it was going to help the resonance, and you can feedback very quickly there. Because this has a limited dynamic range, you actually need a second actuator. And for the lasers that I know of, they actually have sort of a medium speed and a slow speed version. The medium speed thing is a piezoelectric crystal like Weber's sensors can also be used as actuators. You apply a voltage and they stretch or squeeze. And you apply that to either the lasing crystal or some other thing about the mount, and you can modify the wavelength that the laser generates. And for the largest dynamic range but the slowest speed, there are temperature adjustments of the whole laser cavity to warm it up or cool it down, expand it or shrink it. So that's a sketch of how it's done. Now, if you're almost happy but you're wondering how do I get a fast enough sensing so that I can take advantage of this kind of match, let me tell you where the sensing actually comes from. Do you remember when we were talking about Fabry-Perot cavities, we paid most attention to the signal that comes in reflection. That's got the highest bandwidth, the quickest frequency response, and can definitely see fluctuations on the megahertz timescale. So, now it's time for me to come clean with what those components were. So here is the whole system. Here's the Pockel cell. This represents electrodes and the nonlinear crystal. And now here is a polarizing beam splitter and a quarter wave plate, which is a clever invention to make a so-called optical circulator. If you choose the polarization correctly for the light here, what happens is when the light goes in, the polarization gets rotated by this, and when it comes back, it gets rotated again in such a way that if you have a polarizing beam splitter, the same light that could go through this way must turn this way. So you can grab light, the reflected light, and shine it here on an RF photodetector, mix it down to baseband, and then use that to drive your Pockel cell with the error signal.
So the polarization on the other arm, perpendicular arm,
yes,
and the horizontal arm, the polarization must match, right?
Yeah, you have to, right. So this is one laser, and so the beam splitter's over, right, the laser's over here, a beam splitter is here in principle. Okay. There's cleverer ways to do it now than this. This is kind of an old-fashioned set of components that would have too many losses to sustain power recycling, but never mind, we're doing this for pedagogical. Right, so this is in principle one arm, and there's another arm, and you have to keep their lengths matched to the same laser wavelength independently. The actuation signal?
Yeah.
Ah, right. Okay, right. I didn't draw that. The output is here. Slow feedback is probably best done by adjusting the length of the arm. So you fan this out, and one slow version goes to the actuators that apply forces to the mirrors. Those can, in principle, have a big dynamic range, but they don't have a very big bandwidth. That is, they don't let you move things very far very quickly because of the big inertia of the mass. You take another output and send it either as an alternative input, kind of a quasi-DC input to the Pockel cell, and also to the intermediate and slow controllers on the laser. So the actuation is actually done, in this case, four places. Well, okay. One other thing, if we want to do this, this is just drawn for one arm at a time. If we want to do things in an interferometer, we will in fact, we have to find a way to get a signal that measures not the match of the laser wavelength to an individual arm, but to the average of the two arms. And so it doesn't come this way. I'd have to diagram something else for you. So this is what you do to match to one cavity. For two cavities, every interferometer has a common mode error signal and a differential mode error signal. The common mode error signal is about the match of the wavelength to the average of the two arm lengths. The differential one is the one that contains the gravity wave signal. So by the time we get to my very last slide, I think I can show you CARM and DARM. And we'll see how they're generated.
Okay. The high frequency actuation is done on the laser
wavelength. Is on the wavelength, yeah. The highest frequency can be done right here. Yeah. So a whole hierarchy of things. All right. So that was nice because that put some flesh on the bones of this very abstract diagram. Yes.
Common mode signals.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which is the difference between the two input signals.
Okay.
But in case sometimes what happens, you have the kind of same stretches in the both arms. Okay?
Yes.
Uh-huh. But that you don't want kind of thing.
Well, I can tolerate common mode length changes in both arms. I have to correct for them to keep everything matched, but it's not terrible. Common mode things don't confuse me. Right, my interferometer is designed not to sense common mode length changes. In fact, I have to work to find where that CARM signal comes from. We've got it, don't worry. But in terms of it disturbing the gravity wave search, it only needs to be controlled at a poorer level than DARM, okay? Because it doesn't show up in the differential arm length signal. Sorry for slipping into jargon of CARM and DARM, but I hope it's clear. CARM for common mode arm length and DARM for differential arm length. Okay, did I respond to your question? Okay.
I was just asking that gravity will produce differential mode.
Differential only,
but,
right.
You know, internal system will produce like...
Sure, yeah, yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
But
yeah.
Random noise can also...
Yes, random will give both. Yes, random will do both in equal amounts, and we have to control them both. Okay, so we've described the plant, the sensor, the actuator, compensation filter. All right, now I want to mention a few possible design goals. So this is a slightly more abstract way of saying what I said in terms of some examples already. one of the most important applications of feedback to our business is this: holding the plant near a chosen operating point. And we've been working up to this moment all week. So this is a case where I made the mistake on the slide. The command input is zero, but we've got some unavoidable level of disturbance inputs, and that unavoidable level is too big for us to tolerate. So bring in the controls engineer and say, please find a way to make the plant stay near the chosen operating point. And the control engineer says, okay, well, I'll measure how far away I am from the desired operating point. I will do my control engineering magic with my filter and then feed back an input that has nothing to do with this. This is not an operation at all. That such that combined with the disturbance input, magic happens. Now, can anyone see what is the ideal for this purpose? What signal should be here? Should be the negative of this. Okay, that's what we're aiming for. To the extent that we achieve it, this input is small, and therefore this output is small. Now, you can see how abstract this is, right? Because I'm assuming the disturbance input enters on this path. Well, we know that, say, seismic noise shaking arms, it's got a lot of different paths in, and in fact, you know, there's only one or two actuators on, say, the end mirrors. They're not actually the same place, so this addition happens in some spatially distributed way in the real world. Okay, but conceptually, it happens at this point here. So, but now, the sentence that I have in italics is actually the important takeaway lesson. If we're able to do this right, then we have reduced the sensitivity of our plant, or interferometer, or whatever it is, to disturbance inputs. So we found a way to wrap the system that we ostensibly designed with this controls, and then magically it's better behaved in the presence of outside influences. Okay, so that's one of the main accomplishments of feed. Yes? Okay, excellent question. Is the disturbance itself the gravitational wave? Yes. Okay. It reduces sensitivity in the sense that it reduces the motion of the output of the plant. It sounds like I'm saying, but I'm not saying, that it reduces the signal to noise of the response to an input. Okay? So let's pause for a second. So this system gives a compensating force to null out the plant's motion with respect to the input. However, I could have yet another input, a noise input, and if there's noise, the feedback will see it and will come up with a new actuation input to the interferometer that counteracts that noise, that makes that look smaller. All right? So what this does is, in effect, the word sensitivity here means that, in effect, that tiny region where Fabry-Pérot cavity works is effectively lengthened. It can respond over what would otherwise be length excursions that are too long to keep the interferometer in lock. But what this does not mean is it does not reduce the signal-to-noise ratio, because if this represents the noise and this represents the signal, they're both reduced by the same amount. and I just have to make sure that my sensor doesn't have very much noise, and I just look at a smaller level of voltages, and I can still recover the gravity wave against the shot noise the same way. But what I don't have is the problem of the Fabry-Pérot cavity swinging past its linear dynamic range and losing lock. So this is a very particular controls engineering meaning of the word sensitivity. Just means that the plant doesn't respond as far, doesn't swing to the edge or beyond the edge of its dynamic range so easily. But if we're talking about SNR, thank you for making me make that clear. It doesn't actually reduce the other meaning of the word sensitivity, meaning signal to noise ratio, because of how it responds in the same way to signals and noise. Okay, these are all good questions. More. Okay. Another thing, this is another application of feedback that has a different goal. This is the kind of goal we had for taming the high Q resonance of the pendulum or inventing an active isolation system. In this goal of feedback, I rather dramatically change the effective frequency response of the plant without worrying so much about what it's doing to noise inputs. And just say, you know, it has a mechanical resonant frequency of 3 hertz. I wish it had a mechanical resonant frequency of 1 hertz. I can use the design freedom in the filter to find a way to make this whole system have a resonant frequency of 1 hertz, where just the plant alone would have a resonant frequency of 3 hertz. Or if I have a plant with a Q of 1,000,000, I can have the whole thing have a Q of 10,000 or something. So that's calls for rather different thinking. It's different design choices you're going to make when you do that, but it's an almost equally important use of feedback in our business. Okay, so the summary of that is the actuator applies a force that combines with the input so the response of the plant is different than it would have been to external inputs alone, and that can move poles dramatically. All right, so here is the same diagram again, and some of you will be pleased to see that at this moment when I first drew this diagram, I was thinking in the Laplace domain instead of the Fourier domain. So I have spent some time in the Laplace domain. All right, now, between now and lunch, I am going to refer repeatedly to a very particular meaning of G of F. This combination of frequency responses plays an essential role in understanding the behavior, the performance, and the possible weaknesses of a feedback control system. So you will probably recognize that what I have just done is made the product of all the frequency responses around the loop. Plant times sensor times filter times actuator. And now, remember when we were talking about mathematical methods of experimental physics, I said that one of the most amazing things about the frequency domain is that the action of successive signals can be understood by multiplication in the frequency domain instead of a set of three convolution integrals in the time domain. Here is where we're getting that payback, okay? I always need this object, and if I understand these individually, then I know how to multiply four frequency responses together really easily. All right, so this G of F goes by a special name, the loop transfer function, sometimes called the loop gain. Maybe one or two other names, but I will try to call it the loop transfer function. And my assertion is that it's this combination of all the individual ones, the loop transfer function itself determines the benefits of feedback, the extent to which you get reduced sensitivity to input noises, or its details govern how the frequency response of the plant is changed by the feedback. And this also determines whether the servo is stable or unstable, all the things that can be bad about a servo as well. All right, and here is the first statement of the importance of G of F. So I guess I should call this a theorem. Let's let H of F, a letter I haven't used yet, represent any frequency response that you care about in your system between any particular input and any particular output. So it could just represent P of F, or it could represent P times S, or who knows what. If you know that in the absence of feedback, say for example, I open a switch and I don't actually send any input to the actuator, so now there's no feedback active at this moment, and I measure H of F. Now, I close that switch, turn on the feedback, and then the closed loop frequency response between the same input and output pair, so I'll call it H sub CL for closed loop, is the original open loop frequency response divided by 1 plus the loop transfer function. That's my assertion. And let me see if I'm about to prove it. Yeah, I think I'm about to prove it. But even before you see the proof, just knowing that that is the important statement, let's let it sink in a bit. Yes?
So this H is basically G divided by whatever is part of the feedback.
Right, right. That's one way of thinking of it. I mean, you could also have, you know, a second sensor that isn't even part of the loop, and I think you can define an H that includes that as well. But in most cases, what you say is correct. Why is this important? Okay. Thank you. Let's make sure we understand this. So, I've been worried that my plant might have excursions that are too big. My arm length of my FabriPro cavity might swing by too much and have the length go outside the linear dynamic range. If that's the application, and that could be one application of this, I would dearly love to have a FabriPro cavity that only had its length change by 1/10 as much as it used to. So maybe if I can make G large, I can make this overall transfer function between seismic noise input and arm length as an output be small enough so that I stay in lock. So this is a kind of situation where feedback, the goal of feedback is to make G really big. Okay, that's often the case, not always, but it's often one of your goals. I want a feedback system with large loop gain so that I reduce some transfer function from an input that I consider a disturbance to an output that I care about a lot.
So in this example, H would be P of F. H
would be P of F, and this would be P sub CL of F.
From the definition itself, it seems trivial. I mean, this form. Because LCLF, basically, when you, suppose you have open.
Yes, the open loop case.
Then it would be H of F, right?
Right.
But that would be equal to HCF plus whatever your transfer function GF times HCF. Because you put HCF and the total gain of that at these two, that should be the open loop.
I'm glad it's trivial to you. It wasn't trivial to me. And let's finish discussing it, and then if everyone agrees it's trivial, we'll take a vote, and then it's fine. Okay. I would never begrudge anyone insight. So, all right. So let me name some various signals with lowercase letters. And I'm sorry I'm using lowercase I. It's not the square root of minus one. It's just lowercase I. This one is P. This is S. Do I need anything else? I actually only need A, and then I'm done. Oh, D. It's called the disturbance input D. All right. Let's read this one line at a time. So the first statement is that the input to the plant, let's get rid of this noise input, the input to the plant is just the sum of the disturbance input and the actuator input. Okay? That's just an interpretation of this diagram. Now, what is A? A is the net input to the plant multiplied in the frequency domain by P of F times S of F times F of F times A of F. So A is equal to, and I need to emphasize, I'm going to put in an explicit minus sign here. All right? If I didn't put it in explicitly, I could put it in any place else. But in my convention, I'm going to put in an explicit minus sign. So A is equal to I times P times S times F times minus 1 times A, or minus IPSFA. In other words, minus IG. Thus, the sum of D plus A, I, is D, plug in for what A is, minus IG, and therefore the net input to the plant has been reduced by a factor of 1 plus G, and therefore the output is also reduced in the closed loop by that same factor. Now, if you saw that whole thing in your head, my blessing on you. Okay. Yes, same difference. Okay, and you can see that P was just an example. If we're dealing with any frequency response where the input is something inside the servo loop, that the same argument goes through. All right, so any questions about this derivation? Yes. Why the minus sign? All right. Some people don't put the minus sign in. That's a choice. All right. I like this choice because to me it makes vividly clear that the goal of this whole thing is to make A be approximately equal to minus D. You can either do that with an explicit minus sign or hiding a minus sign in the definition of one of these frequency responses. Algebraically, it doesn't matter. But what's physically really important is that A be approximately minus D. That's how it works. Now, I will tell you, when I have built my own servos, I have always despaired about keeping track of every sign all the way around. Sometimes it's because I don't want to keep track of how many inverting amplifiers I've used in my filter, and sometimes it's because I don't want to have to remember which polarity the magnet was glued on to something. So every time I've ever built a servo, I've put in a little sign flipping switch, and you turn it on, and if it's the wrong sign, you know it right away because it makes horrible noises on the way to instability, and then you quick throw it to the other way. With coils and magnets, it's even easier. You lift the two input leads and attach them in the other orientation to your drive amplifier. But there is only one physically correct sign, whether you make it explicit or implicit, and that is whatever makes A approximately equal to minus D. So beware, if you read some feedback control books, don't put the explicit minus sign in, and then this same denominator is written as 1 minus G. Doesn't matter. It only matters if it confuses you. Okay, so here's a way of saying in words what we've already seen, that, let me write that theorem again. So the only action of feedback is by the action of that denominator. Okay? So if you are hoping your feedback will make a big effect, what you want is 1 plus g to be big, which since 1 is 1, that means g should be big. Similarly, at any set of frequencies where g is much less than 1, the feedback is doing effectively nothing. So that's already, I hope, making it clear why I was asserting that the benefits of feedback are encoded in the function g. Now, we'll see in more detail what comes from this, but that's already the basic idea, that if you're using feedback because, boy, if you don't effectively make seismic noise smaller by a factor of 100, you can't keep your arm in lock, all right, then you want g to be 100 or more. Okay, that's often, although not always, what you're trying to do with feedback. Yes?
It's analogous to the Barkhausen criteria that decides the gain of an op amp.
Okay, I'm not sure I know the Barkhausen criterion, but I do know that op amps, in fact, have a whole bunch of internal feedback.
But then you decide the total gain as open loop gain by 1 plus the gain into the feedback ratio.
There you go.
It's
right. Yes, yes, yes. Effectively identical to that. Yes. So for those of you who have studied the theory of how you use op amps, you've just heard a really nice summary of it. All right. I would like us to now do a little design exercise together. And this is a system we've thought about a bit. A simple harmonic oscillator implemented slightly differently. So here's a mass hung as a pendulum. So we shouldn't be surprised if we remember that it's got the dynamics of a mass on a spring. I want to use it slightly differently. The last time we had a simple harmonic oscillator and we're thinking of the frequency response, we made the input be the position of the top of the spring and took the output to be the position of the bottom of the spring. Here, I still want the same output, the position of the bottom of the spring, although I'm thinking of it in horizontal terms. But I want the input to that to be a force applied to this mass. So how about, can we sketch already the open loop response? So can we sketch P of F. Tell me about the low frequency response. If I push at a frequency that's very low compared with the resonance frequency, does the response of the mass depend on the frequency other than that it's being low? No. So it's independent of frequency in the low frequency limit. Now, it's not unity because note, that doesn't even make sense. The dimensions of our input and output are different. But OK, it's some number. All right. At high frequencies, what do we know? It's 1 by F squared. All right. And where are these two are going to come together? It's some sort of resonant peak. Great. OK. Now, maybe that resonant Q is too high for some reason, okay? And it's not our job as a servo engineer to ask, what do you mean it's too high? We want to listen to our employer and say, I think it's too high and I want you to reduce the effective Q. So the question is, can I use feedback so that if I step back and don't look what's happening here and just ask, if I applied another force, what would be the response of the mirror? Can I design something inside that black box that would reduce the Q The clue is drawn on the screen. Who wants to use their own insight plus whatever clues they see on the screen to propose a design?
Increase the gain at that frequency.
All right, but the gain, all right. So we definitely want some sort of gain there. But let's try to think for a moment. Let's step out. I've invited everyone to be a servo engineer for an hour and a half. But let's step out of being servo engineers and think like a physicist for a moment. Yeah, you'd want to add some damping. Okay. And in spite of everything I said yesterday about, oh, you know, don't think about velocity damping, you know, there's this internal things in materials that cause internal friction. As physicists, we think, well, one way to add damping is to ensure somehow or other that there's a force proportional to velocity with the appropriate sign, force negative sign, applied to this. Okay, so how can I take a signal that measures the location of a mass, the coordinate of a mass, and somehow end up with information about the velocity of that mass? Transduce in what way? This is already my transducer. Imagine I have something that gives me a bigger voltage when the mass is farther to the right and a smaller voltage when it's to the left. I don't want a spring, no. How do I take a measure, some function of time that is proportional to position? Can I perform any operations on that and turn it into another function of time that's proportional to velocity? Yeah, take a time derivative, okay? Which I can either do by digitizing and then typing in some command to take a derivative, or I can build myself a high-pass filter, and in the ramp-up, this is not to be a lesson in filter design, so only pay attention to this if you know what I'm talking about when I say, oh, I've just built a high-pass filter. And in this regime, no, I do want to say it. Okay, I do want to say it. What in the frequency domain is the implementation or the, what is x dot in the frequency domain? Omega. It's I omega x. So if I build myself a filter whose output is an increasing function of frequency by one power of frequency, actually, that is a time derivative taking filter. Okay? So, two resistors and a capacitor implements this over a finite range of frequencies. Okay? So, let's draw the rest of the Bode plot. Let's draw the phase. What's the phase at low frequencies? Phase is zero. What's the phase at high frequencies? It's minus pi. So depending on the Q is high, there's a really sharp, steep decline from zero to minus 180 degrees. All right, now, what is the Bode diagram of my filter? If I'm making a differentiator. Something like that, right? That's got to be the magnitude characteristic. Now it's probably going to roll off like that at low and high frequencies. I'll leave that as smudges for now. And let's think about mainly this. Okay. Later I'm going to show you a slide with the answer to this, but let me skip ahead because this is really important. there is a wonderfully powerful theorem in servo design that comes from complex analysis that says you can't independently specify the magnitude of a frequency response and the phase of a frequency response. That if you know the magnitude over all frequencies, you have uniquely specified up to a kind of ambiguity that we can put aside, because you don't want to go there, okay? You have, fingers crossed, uniquely specified phi of f, okay? So that's a very powerful theorem that you can't evade. There is an approximation to that that says if over a sufficiently broad frequency range, the magnitude of your frequency response is some power law, I've written it as f to the minus n for some perverse reason, then the phase over that same frequency range is going to approximately be equal to that same exponent minus n times 90 degrees. Yes, yes, and in fact, it's the iron grip of this theorem that makes control engineering really difficult. Okay.
It's not valid for a generic complex function.
No, this is for a generic. This is a generic. Any analytic function has this property. I believe I'm quoting the theorem correctly, but someone who understands things like this better is nodding, so I feel better.
Analytic function is yes. Really correct.
Yes. Okay. All right, so, but in particular, a network response or a loop transfer function of something that obeys causality, I think, is then guaranteed to be represented by the mathematics of an analytic function. So I think that's where this comes from. So I taught you something. I taught you something from complex analysis. Oh, isn't that great? I feel really good. All right, but mostly this is, this has its good side and its bad side. Because this tells me the answer that I wanted to know. That's the good side. That in this range where we've got proportional to f to 1 to the 1 to the first power, that the phase is plus 90 degrees. That's the good part. I know if I've got one, I've got the other. Bad part is if I've got one, I've got the other. And here's how I can tell. I'll hint. We'll come back before lunch to the reason I put this later. Normally, I'm dealing with situations where responses roll off, either because things must roll off at high enough frequencies anyway. That's another theorem of complex analysis, I think. Or because in order for me to get a big G at low frequencies, my strategy is to roll it off from low to high, and I'll explain why later. So normally, I'm dealing with negative phases, and if I'm stuck with or trying to achieve really steep roll-offs, then I am getting big negative phases. Now,
this 90 degree, of course, could have been guessed because the filter was
I omega. It's just I omega, and that I is plus 90. Right, exactly. Right, so this is not saying things that you can't figure out in any other way. It's just telling you how general it is. Okay, but now remember, we've got umpty-ump over 1 plus g. Now, I'm going to say something heuristic where the actual theorems are hard to say precisely, but the heuristic does work. What is the one thing I do not want to happen no matter what to that denominator?
G should not be minus 1.
Yes, right. G should not be minus 1. Well, darn it. I might generate a situation where phi is minus 180 or plus 180. They're the same thing. I'm in danger of making my servo unstable because I'm unable to independently control the phase while I'm trying to manipulate the magnitude to achieve some design goal. So I think I'm doing my design by saying, oh, I want to make G really, really big. Oh, except, okay, to make it really big down at 10 hertz, it had better be falling like 1/(frequency cubed) before it gets to 1 kilohertz, oh my goodness, and something terrible happens. All right, so that's the terrible thing, but we'll come back to the terrible thing later. We're just trying to finish our design exercise here. So let's go back to where we were. All right, so if this is the Planck transfer function, and if, just to make life simple, I imagine that I have a completely frequency-independent sensor and a completely frequency-independent actuator, so that the only other frequency dependence is my compensation filter, can we now draw the Bode diagram for the loop transfer function? It should be. It should be this, maybe coming up, and then a peak, and coming down more shallowly, and maybe this rolls off, so maybe that becomes level, maybe not, maybe this rolls off like that. But in the middle then, what we've got is plus 90 and minus 90. And it's up to us whether this goes to zero there and whether this continues on down to minus 180 or not. All right. Now, over what range of frequency? Oh, sorry.
How can a phase be positive? Doesn't it mean a phase gain? I mean,
we can have positive phases. We can surely have positive. We can have phase leads.
Lag and lead.
Yeah, I can.
If
you gave me 20 minutes on the internet, I could look up a filter design that has, well, no, we've already invented a filter. This is a high-pass filter.
Is your phase between minus 180 and 180?
Yes, yeah.
So, I mean, what I was thinking is that this is like
minus 270 or something. And
yeah, I mean, because
all right. In strictly speaking, in the world where all sinusoids have been in place from minus t equals minus infinity and on into the future, those are indistinguishable. Nevertheless, I think it's actually meaningful that I should think of it as positive. Let me assert that and don't challenge me on it. We'll representative positive for sure. All right, so now, over what range of frequencies do we need the magnitude of G to be large in order to get the benefit that we want? Do we need it to be large down here? Do we care if it's large down here? No, we just want to tame the Q. We just want to lop this off, right? Okay, so we complete the design by saying, let's set this equal to magnitude G equals 1. The so-called unity gain point is right there. And then we don't have to worry about the phases far from here. That's why I allowed myself to be sloppy about whether this was a genuine differentiator forever or just differentiator over a finite range. So let's see if we got it right together. Oh yeah, all right. So that is the loop gain of this system with active damping wrapped around it. That's just what we invented. And now, here is the calculated closed loop response. In dashes, that's the original open loop response. The action of that servo is just to tame the Q at the peak, leave it alone every place else. Neat, huh? Okay, you're all servo designers now. It's great. All right. So here is a sketch. Please look up. Here's the answer to your question. Or one version of the answer, or I'm only drawing in one of the feedback paths. We actually did a better job of this together. But there it is. Now, here's an interesting one. This one's a lot of fun. The mathematics is just hard enough that we can't do it all together, but it would make a really nice homework problem, advanced homework problem. So let's say I've got some table, and I would like that table to vibrate less than it does even though it's sitting on springs. So I imagine that this ground that it's sitting on is shaking up and down, and that's causing too much shaking here. I might also say I worried about too much shaking here. Let's put that aside for the moment. One thing I can do is put a second suspended mass on top of this table, and I can look at how far apart those masses are, the extent to which these springs are getting stretched and compressed. If this spring is getting compressed, that must largely be due to this table moving up, accelerating. If it's trying to push upwards, it must push this up by compressing the spring. So if I measure this gap and then appropriately filter it and apply a force with an appropriate sign here, I can use this actuator to apply compensating forces to this table that counteract the ground shaking forces that were transmitted by the spring. And that will make this sit more still, and by the way, it will also make this sit more still, because this is just a simple harmonic oscillator mounted here where this is its input. So this is the basic idea of active seismic isolation that's been implemented in advanced LIGO. And maybe I will just sketch for you without proof what the open loop and closed loop transfer functions look like.
So the feedback control system is for every component of the LIGO. It's not the overall. So you have a feedback system to control the main position.
Yes.
How many?
Oh, a lot. I'll show you a diagram in a bit. You know what? It's close enough to lunch. I'm not going to do this. I just want to tell you this is incredibly charming, and if you want to know more about this, ask me and I will send you to a reference about it. But it's a way of creating artificially low resonant frequencies from springs that are so stiff that they ought to be giving you high resonant frequencies. Let's let it go at that. All right. Now here's where I formally mention that there's a topic that goes in the literature under the name costs of feedback. It doesn't mainly mean that I have to spend money on sensors and actuators and the salaries of control engineers, although you do need to do that. But the cost is we've created a new kind of possibility of failure that did not exist when we had no feedback. And that is the failure that is servo instability. If I improperly designed my servo, or if I put it in the wrong operating regime, something that was sitting more or less still but not quite still enough for my taste suddenly starts shaking like mad. Okay, so I have the capability through accident or inattention to detail of making things much worse. Now, because everything that feedback does depends on the loop transfer function G, so too does the possibility of feedback depend on G. And now I want to assert by hinting why we have the filter F. The filter F must be designed for two purposes. One, to try to make the magnitude of G do what you want for benefits, but while simultaneously avoiding the kinds of faults that will cause instability. Okay, and almost always your first inclination of how to achieve your desired specification will run afoul of the second problem, and your first guess is almost always going to be unstable. And it's a rich subject. Now, we started on this already. We don't want G to be minus one. Okay, does anybody remember when the late Steve Jobs was defending one model of the iPhone against this problem that you could short out the antenna by putting your finger across the gap between the metal parts of that were the antenna. No one remembers this? You remember. Do you remember what he said? He says, just don't hold it that way. Yeah. All right. So you might be tempted to say, well, just don't make G equal to minus one, and then you're done. Unfortunately, it's, I don't know, I thought Steve Jobs was a hero around the world, but maybe not. All right. He's a hero to almost all of my friends, but never mind. All right. So when I first learned this subject, I said, it's easy. Why hasn't anyone thought of this before? Just make G large for every frequency, and then you're done, right? That's great. But you can't. And this is another, this is probably not a theorem of complex analysis, probably a theorem of physics, okay? That making G large means that I can push a lot at arbitrarily high frequencies, among other things, okay? But I cannot do that. All right. It's easiest for me to see that by seeing that if I'm dealing, and I'll stick with the mechanical examples, if I'm dealing with something made of stuff, that stuff has a finite speed of sound. So if I push at a really high frequency here and think that this is tracking, it's not. I'm launching waves in there, and I might launch a wave at a frequency that is an internal resonance, might set up a standing wave on the other side of which the end moves in antiphase. So the thing you know is going to happen is you're going to have sign changes, which is to say 180 degree phase lags inserted every time you go through an inline mechanical resonance. I think it's not too much harder to say that you can't have fixed magnitude, but the problem is there, even if you could have fixed magnitude at high frequencies, there's no way you can have fixed signs, okay? And it's not just limited to mechanical systems, there's always transmission delays electromagnetically or whatever, right? So you cannot just do the thing I wanted. So you accumulate phase lags, and the only ultra-safe thing that you can do in the presence of high-frequency phase lags, which generally come from resonances. So now, here's G of F. This is some generic servo. So here my phase is good. Here my phase is, it's already kind of like minus 180 if I didn't compensate it. Now, as soon as I get here, my phase is definitely pulled through the minus one point, while at the same time, I've got a peak in my gain. So this had better be below one. So that already tells me that I basically can't turn up the loop gain of a servo loop with this loop transfer function. I can get a couple factors of 10 maybe, depending on exactly what frequency these resonances are coming in. And otherwise, I'm kind of screwed. And if I thought I was going to be clever and added a phase lead like I did with the velocity thing, that buys me maybe one resonance worth of trouble and maybe nothing at all. Okay? So if I want to make it so that I can have higher gain up here, but not run into trouble with instability because of this kind of problem, I've got to do some really tricky things. And that's where the design of the filter F comes from. And it's limited by this theorem that we talked about. And even figuring out in advance what's going to be stable and what's not takes some good mathematics. Been having a debate with one of you about the merits of the Laplace domain versus the Fourier domain. There is no simple test, right, for stability in the Fourier domain. Well, there is the Nyquist diagram that we were talking about. That's semi-simple. Anyway, just keeping track of this and then within what's allowed and what's not allowed, designing a clever capital F of F to make capital G of F do what you want is a trick. All right. Let's finish by looking at the length control diagram. Okay, this is simplified. All right. So the gravity wave signal is marked here. All right, here's the dark port. This is from initial LIGO. So this signal is the one that carried the gravity wave information. And a low frequency version of that is fed back in antiphase to the two N test masses. Here it is going directly here, and here it is going through an inverting amplifier to there. But now we need common mode information to lock the laser input beam. Okay, so that information comes from the signal reflected from the recycling mirror, properly demodulated. That's where we learned the mismatch between the average of the two arms and the laser wavelength. But in addition, let's see, we needed feedback to the recycling mirror, so we needed a signal that gives a measure of the average length of those two arms, and that comes from looking at the phase of light that bounces off the ostensibly non-reflecting surface of the beam splitter. That gets demodulated and fed back here. We also need a differential control for the relative position of those two input mirrors, and that we get from another place. Okay, that's just a baby version of the real feedback loop, a set of feedback loops. And now remember that we have to keep things aligned, and pendulums swing from side to side. So there needs to be a whole parallel set of alignment control loops. We haven't even talked about how you sense alignment. It would only take a few minutes, but we're running late. So ask me if you want to know how you sense the alignments of the mirrors.
But if each component has its own separate feedback loop,
yes, right?
The whole system,
yes?
Since the whole system is connected together,
yes,
the actuators might be talking to each other.
Yes, we sure hope not, but they can, yes. And let's bring that up again during tutorial this afternoon, okay? But yes, it's complicated. Nobody ever said it was going to be simple to detect gravity waves. At least nobody ever said it to me. Right? Okay, that's my formal material. Let's break. I'll take questions individually or over lunch. Yes, I hope so too. And let me say thank you all to you guys are a great bunch of students. Fabulous.